From the studios of Staten Island Community Television, you're watching In the Bleachers, the TV show for the world's most passionate sports fans. Hello, everyone. I'm the official team psychologist for the New York Jets, Dr. Jaime Hixson.
Hi, I'm Tom Brady's manager, also known as Eric Rosen.
We're very, very happy that you could join us, folks. And one of the best parts about the show tonight is the fact that our good friend Rob Assomening is on the other side of the glass, which means not only is he going to be calling the shots, he's also taking phone calls for us at 718-727-0143. And also you can check us out on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and Snapchat. So if you got something to say, call us up because we would love to hear from you. Now, the reason why I made that little joke is because every Jet fan right now is probably on suicide watch, because not only is their boss, not only is their team's boss, Woody Johnson, going to be taking a job as the ambassador to the UK, the Jets' most bitter rival, the Patriots, are going to be in the Super Bowl for a NFL record 9th time. 7 times under Tom Brady and Bill Belichick as the same duo together.
I'll be honest, that is a bit of a stretch. We're not exactly, you know, thrilled that we got a call, you're in the Bleachers.
Just as we speak, we wound up getting ourselves a phone call. So, hello, you're in the Bleachers.
Hello?
I think we might have another mime impersonation over the other end, but we'll keep on trying. I think we might have a little technical difficulty. You know what? We'll see if we can get it fixed. But in the meantime, you said it best. It is a bit of a stretch considering how the Patriots got here.
Well, it's not. I don't think we're on suicide watch. I just think that, you know, it's upsetting that, you know, that the Jets had to go through yet a 6th straight season of missing the playoffs. If Woody Johnson wants to take the post of being ambassador to the United Kingdom, that's his choice. He's allowed to do that. And you know what? At the same time, he's divesting his interest to his brother, who will take over the team. Who knows? Maybe actually his brother will do a better job with the team in his stead for next season and beyond, depending on how long he takes this job as ambassador to the UK. As for the New York Jets, as New England Patriots in the postseason, you know what? I'm not one of those Jet fans who's bitter about New England. You know, I'm not. I know I'm supposed to. I'm supposed to hate Tom Brady with my guts and my heart, but I don't hate Tom Brady. In fact, I'm a bit jealous, a little envious, you know, for the success that he's had. You know what? Rightfully so. Look at what he's done with this team. He's going to his 7th appearance in the Super Bowl. He's won 4 of those previous 6 appearances that he was in. It's unbelievable. He just had his 9th, 3rd, 3 touchdown performance in the postseason, and not to mention their head coach, Bill Belichick, is going to a 7th Super Bowl appearance, which is an all-time record amongst head coaches. And yet Brady has a chance to have his 5th victory, which would be the tie for the most in NFL history with Bart Starr, who had 2 Super Bowls and 3 NFL championships. And on top of that, Belichick would have the most as a coach in NFL history over Chuck Knoll, who he's currently tied with. And the way this Patriots organization, the way they scheme against their teams week in and week out, and despite the fact that Tom was missing the first 4 games and yet came back with a vengeance, 28 touchdowns, 2 interceptions, best touchdown to interception ratio in NFL history. I'm not that 1 ounce mad at the New England Patriots. In fact, I'm envious. I'm envious.
Well, let's put it this way. Bill Belichick is going to be coaching in his 7th Super Bowl. Overall, he's going to be in his 10th total Super Bowl appearance. Because keep in mind, before he took the Patriots job, he spent 15 years as an assistant here in New York. 12 years with the Giants.
Parcells.
8 of those years were with Bill Parcells, and then another 3 years with the Jets when Parcells came over here from New England after he left in that power struggle with the Patriots boss, Mr. Kraft.
Please don't remind me of the 24-hour, let me write it on a cocktail napkin.
Yep. And then after, that was after Bill Parcells decided to resign from the Jets. It was when Belichick became head coach for a day, and he scribbled his resignation on a piece of paper. But think what could have been if Bill Belichick had just remained with the Jets for more than 24 hours. Would they have drafted Tom Brady? Would they have had a deflate gate or a bounty gate or
any successive
spy gate scandal in their stead? Would they have had all of those Super Bowl victory parades coming down the streets of Manhattan?
They never had bounty gate. That was actually.
And that was the Saints. Let me correct myself.
But they, Spygate was definitely, that was New England back in 07. And every time they've had a scandal, whether it was, you know, Spygate or now Deflategate, they somehow find a way to get to the ultimate prize, get to the final showdown. Because they love how teams, they feel like the media has disrespected them in some way. They feel as though some fans outside Foxborough have disrespected and say they can't win without cheating. So they love to have that, I'm going to prove it to you attitude.
Mm-hmm.
And they do. They prove it every week.
And just to give you an idea about the Patriots' history, before the Bill Belichick, Tom Brady era, the Patriots' history goes back to the American Football League in 1960. You know how many times the Patriots made the playoffs when they were in the old AFL? And this is 10 years of AFL history. You know how many times they made the playoffs?
How many?
One. And then after the merger in 1970, they had some decent teams. In fact, the first Super Bowl team that they had was 1985 when they went past the Jets, the Raiders, and the Dolphins en route to Super Bowl 20.
And then got their But summarily handed them 46-10 and then by that defense.
And
the
then
Bears
there was when Parcells wound up going to New England, he was there 4 years. You could argue that maybe this whole thing might have turned around when Bill Belichick first became the head coach in 1993. It took him 4 years to make the Patriots a Super Bowl contender. Then after that, he got into a really nasty divorce with Robert Kraft, came to the Jets for 3 years. When you think about it, the Patriots' real glory days kind of sort of unwittingly started with Bill Parcells. But consider this. Before Belichick got to New England, the Patriots were at least 35 to 40 games, I would say around 70 games under 500 as a franchise for their history. But ever since this regime took over, Bill Belichick has won over 200 games, including playoffs, lost only 70. He's 22-9 in the postseason. Bill Belichick, you could argue, could very well be the single greatest coach in NFL history. And this is considering guys like
Bill Walsh, Chuck Knoll,
who won four Super Bowls. Bill Walsh won four Super Bowls of his own. Vince Lombardi was a genius coaching the Packers.
Tom Landry,
who won two Super Bowls. Don Shula, who won two Super Bowls with the Dolphins. George Halas, who won multiple titles with the Bears. Bill Belichick could very well be the single greatest head coach of this era. And that's saying a lot, considering that we mentioned all those other guys.
And Dan Reeves, to be honest, was a great coach. He was one of the greatest coaches never to win. Mm-hmm. That's the thing, you know. That's what, you know, now that brings me to the Atlanta Falcons, because the last time they made the Super Bowl was when the Dirty Birds, led by, you know, the 1999 Falcons.
The January 99 Falcons, which had Chris Chandler as their starting quarterback. And Chris Chandler was basically a journeyman sandwiched around his time playing for the Falcons. And that Falcon team had Chandler, Jamal Anderson, Terrence Mathis, who was an ex-Jet, and several other high-profile guys who who had a really, really good thing going, but then things just fell apart for them after that season. But you could argue the Falcons, whose history goes back to 1966, could be one of the most star-crossed franchises in NFL history. Aside from 1998 and this year, have they really had that one signature moment in their franchise's history?
They've had several. Yeah, I think under Matt Ryan, they've had several signature moments under this guy's time in the nine seasons he's been with this team. And the fact that this is going to be his first Super Bowl appearance.
Mm-hmm.
He truly showed us Matty Ice this season. 38 yeah. touchdowns, 6 interceptions. Guy was 46 yards shy, 5,000 yards, 117 pass rating the entire season. Best in the NFL. He is without a doubt this year's MVP candidate. And 5 total touchdowns yesterday, 4 passing, and he had 1 on the ground, which was unbelievable in and of itself. Let's go through the games, starting with the NFC game that started the early slate at 3:05 on Fox. You had Matt Ryan's team. They were up 10-0. Aaron Rodgers and company were just struggling left and right. And you have to give it up to the Packers this season. The fact that they were a 4-6 team, and what does Aaron Rodgers do, like the year when he told people to relax? He says to the media, I think we can run the table. And what mm-hmm. do? They ran 6 straight victories to end the season to go 10-6. They get to their 8 straight postseason appearance. They've won, out of those 8 times, 6 division titles in the NFC North. And they won 2 straight games, including the upset over the Dallas Cowboys. I know my mom, my brother, and Sean Dennis and so many other Cowboy fans were not thrilled with that, but you have to give it up to what they did in those 2 games. And the fact that they came up short, they were just there was no cigar in this game for them. And what really killed me was they were up 10-0. They had a chance to be within 3 points. And then Aaron Ripkowski with 2 people on him, when he should have just fell down with the ball, what happens? The ball gets snapped right out from him. The Falcons recover. It leads to that Matt Ryan rushing touchdown, and that's what changed the whole momentum.
That was the turning point right there. But you can't really fault him for trying to give the effort. You want your players to give the best effort on the field, and he was carrying about 3 or 4 guys inside the 5-yard line. It just so happens that the defender made a terrific play ripping the ball away.
But at that point, if you got 2 people holding each leg and all that, that should be a clue to you. Drop on yourself. You already had the first down. Just drop right now so at least you
He wasn't going to do that. He was going to try and well, he was going to crawl to the end zone if he had to. He just should have secured the ball a little bit better. If there was any mistake that he made, it was the fact that he didn't really secure the ball that well. And can't really fault him for doing what he had to do.
And you also have to blame the Packers secondary. This was a team that was 21st in the league. That's the problem with this team. Too many injuries in that secondary yep. and very little coverage. Like, I mean, that zone coverage scheme that they had was pitiful to watch. You look at the plays of Julio Jones. In that rushing touchdown drive that they had after the fumble, he had 3 catches of 56 yards. Altogether, he had 9 catches, 180 yards, 2 big touchdowns, by the way. The one that where he crossed the field, mm-hmm. went to the right side, broke 2 defenders down the right sideline for that touchdown, getting in. And the other one where he just had this crazy fade route, keeping both his feet in bounds and catching the ball. Julio Jones is just as big a reason why this Falcons yeah. team is good, as well as Matt Ryan. But the O-line, I think, has been the unspoken story, really.
Yeah, specifically when they brought in Alex Mack from the Browns, to play center. He was the glue for that entire offensive line, which started every single play of every single regular season game this year and into the playoffs as well.
None of them were injured. This was the only offensive line that had every starter from week 1 up until the Super Bowl week. Can you think of any offensive line in the last 10 years that has had that kind of consistency?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think anybody can name one that really stood that. Yeah, that type of, consistency for sure.
If I can do a little nitpicking for a second, this should be a hint to both of our local teams as far as how to start building a championship contender. Start with your offensive line. Get some really strong, durable guys that can help pave the way for your running game and your passing game. Just saying.
Yeah, especially a guy like Alex Mack, who before last season, he had a qualifying, because he was a restricted free agent, he had a qualifying offer from the Jacksonville Jaguars. And the Cleveland Browns matched it, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So he had to stay one more pitiful season in Cleveland before he got to the promised land at the ATL, and it's worked out for him. And how about the draft of Jake Matthews, who, by the way, is the cousin of Clay Matthews, who played, and Claiborne, too. Like, that offensive line from the left to the right side has paved the way for guys like Devonta Freeman and Tevin Coleman to not only run but catch out of the backfield, to see guys like Taylor Gabriel catch crazy plays in the flats, to Toilolu and all these. And how about the flip pass to Mohamed Sanu that started off the game?
That was genius, to be honest with you.
Like, everything that the Falcons did, like Dan and even Kyle Shanahan, who right now, as we're speaking, is probably going to accept the 49ers job. You know, so he'll no longer be in the shadows of his father. Now he gets to coach his own team for the first time.
Let's see if he can get past these next couple of weeks without any more distractions, first of all.
I know. That's the thing, too. He's going to have to devise a game plan against, you know, arguably the best defense they're going up against. Because the other defenses they played against were,
I'm
talking about the Seahawks defense. They played, you know, well, and that's because they didn't have Earl Thomas, all right?
Yeah.
If they had Earl Thomas, that game could have been a different story, honestly. Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure if one guy can really make a whole defense, but I think it was pretty coincidental that without him there, Matt Ryan was able to pick apart that Seahawks secondary. He especially made Richard Sherman the object of his desire, if you will, because it seemed like every time Matt Ryan was throwing towards his direction, Sherman was getting burned really badly.
Especially by Julio, because if you recall early in the season, that 26-24 game that the Seahawks won with that controversial no call on pass interference, believe me, Julio Jones wanted redemption. He wanted to get back at Sherman for that game, and they did, and they won handily.
Mm-hmm.
And then you look at these last five games alone, and these last six games that the seven games that they won, the Falcons have not had a single. Yeah, there's been no pick at all. Actually, six games, no pick for Matt Ryan.
That is the key to building a really nice run in the playoffs. Take care of the football. And lost in this entire celebration was two things. One, there was some really dangerous weather going on in Georgia and throughout the South because there were some tornadoes that were really peltering that part of the country. And two, yesterday's game was the very last football game that was played in the Georgia Dome.
The Georgia Dome has been the host of many great events. You think of the 96 games in Atlanta where, you know, the Magnificent Seven won the first U.S. Olympic women's gymnastics team won the gold medal there in the team all-around competition. And then you look at some of the great moments that took place, especially the 23 SEC title games, including some of my Gator teams that have won there, which I'm so proud of.
The Peach Bowl, of course, which is always held in the Georgia Dome. One time they had the Sugar Bowl take place in the Georgia Dome around the time of Hurricane Katrina.
You know, the Georgia Dome has, you know, held so many great. One of my favorite events, if you're a WWE or a wrestling fan, Monday Nitro, the night when Goldberg fought Hulk Hogan for the World Heavyweight Championship.
Yeah.
Probably one of my favorite moments.
Mm-hmm.
He was going in. He had over 173 straight wins, one of them being at the Georgia Dome, where, by the way, Goldberg played there because he was an Atlanta Falcon before he even joined WCW.
Yep. Those were the days when the Falcons played at the old Fulton County Stadium. And, of course, since the Super Bowl is coming up, I think there have been either two or three Super Bowls that have been held inside the Georgia Dome.
The most famous being the 23 Super Bowl 34, where the St. Louis Rams beat the Titans 23-16, the one-yard short game.
Mm-hmm.
One of the most memorable games in Super Bowl history.
Yep.
You know, it's crazy. 1 yard short of forcing overtime, which has never been done, as well as no host team has ever been in a Super Bowl.
Yep. Do you know that I've been hearing some rather unflattering things about the crowd noise that has been going on for every Falcon home game? Some people don't seem to think that it's that loud for Falcon games. They seem to think that the noise gets kind of muffled in a way when you watch it on television. But you have to be inside that stadium to know how loud it gets, because I can tell you right now, it had to have been really loud seeing all those Falcon fans wearing red and black, watching their team go win the NFC title and clinch a Super Bowl berth.
And not just win, they won 44-21. It was another a great game for them. In these games that they've won recently, the lowest amount of points that they've won by was 33, week 16 against the Panthers. Other than that, they scored 40 or more points in three of their six victories. Mm-hmm. That's amazing in and of itself. This was a team that scored the most points in the league, by the way. 70 more points than the next closest team.
Yep.
They can score in bunches. They got receivers left and right.
And Matt Ryan happened to out-duel two Super Bowl-winning quarterbacks, Russell Wilson and last night, Aaron Rodgers.
Oh, yeah, right.
Now he's going to go up a big-time step in class, because he has to face a four-time Super Bowl champion in a couple of weeks, Tom Brady.
There was a lot of pressure on Matt. But then again, we call him Matty Ice for a reason. But you know what?
He had a reputation for not winning the big game in his career. It's been following him since his days in Boston College. But now he finally won a big game. The NFC Championship is a big game. The last game of the year is the big game.
Especially it was at night, 6:40 in Foxborough, Massachusetts, a town of hardworking working-class Americans, a town of 70,000 people.
Well, that's how much the stadium holds. When you think about it,
it's more than that.
The town of Foxborough itself is not really that big.
I know.
I don't even think it's about 26,000.
Yep. And it's a place where, you know, it's your common everyday working blue-collar citizens who just get together and all that. But the one thing that's the common thread, despite all different types of politics, religion, ethnicity, the one thing that binds that town is their love for the Patriots. Mm-hmm. And last night they got to see their Pats and those Minutemen right there with their muskets go up against the Steelers. Talk about hardworking citizens right there in Pittsburgh, steel town right there, you know, blue-collar people. So it was like one blue-collar city versus another. It was an epic showdown. It was a really good matchup. This is the first time they faced each other in this particular game since Roethlisberger's rookie season.
Yeah. Just to give you an idea about the road that Tom Brady has taken, he has played in the last six AFC championship games. In 17 years, he's played in 11 AFC championship games. And he has beaten Peyton Manning, Ben Roethlisberger now twice, and the only guy that he's lost to has been Peyton Manning twice. In fact, they've gone up against each other in the playoffs four times, Manning and Brady, and they've split the four meetings between them.
How about the fact that
the other guy he's lost to, Joe Flacco.
13 of the last 14 AFC representatives in the Super Bowl were either Tom Brady, Ben Roethlisberger, or Peyton Manning.
Mm-hmm.
The only year that wasn't the case was Joe Flacco.
Yep.
In 2012. Other than that, that's insane right there to think about. That's the limited amount of quarterbacks that have represented the AFC in the big game.
Mm-hmm. You talk about being envious of the Patriots' success, especially the success that they've had with Bill Belichick and Tom Brady on the same sidelines. Can we now put any of this doubt to rest that the Patriots are the class of this entire sport, much less the league itself? 11 AFC championship games in the last 17 years and seven championship game victories. It's of course, this is more than just Belichick and Brady. I mean, they've won with a hodgepodge of many different players. I mean, they've won with guys like Rishe Caldwell and
Wes Welker.
Most recently, there's been Julian Edelman and Danny Amendola. The list just goes on and on. This is what's been so amazing about this run. Tom Brady has worked with a plethora of receivers and tight ends, and he still seems to get better with age.
He's 39 years old. This is the second straight year that the AFC not only has another aging quarterback, but yet he plays like he's still in his 20s. He has a diet and a regimen that's unlike any other person in his career, in any sport whatsoever. He really, you know, that's why he plays like he's so young, because you see what he does on the field, the way he commands that offense, you know, that huddle right there. He has such great vision, like Peyton Manning, mm-hmm. and even Roethlisberger at times. They have this vision to be able to see where the players are going. Like, take yesterday, for instance, that flea flicker play that Chris Hogan, who was his primary target, 9 catches, 180 yards, 2 touchdowns, but that 34-yard flea flicker right there. The way the ball was tossed from one player to him, and the way that Hogan was able to get himself from the left side down to the right and to separate himself in the right corner right there. Genius.
Yeah.
In every aspect of that play. The timing was perfect. The throw was perfect. Yeah.
That's a credit to the offensive coordinator. In this case, it's Josh McDaniels for calling a play like that. That's number one.
Who's going to be a coach next year.
Yeah. Eventually, he's going to get a second chance, because after failing miserably with the Broncos the first time, I think he's learned his lesson enough where he really does need to have the right situation in order to get to that next level on his own.
Just not Cleveland. Don't go to Cleveland. Let Matt Patricia go to Cleveland.
Well, Cleveland already has Hugh Jackson, and they want to be able to give him at least one more chance.
Until he messes up yet again, because, you know, Cleveland is Siberia for any coach.
Well, let's put it this way.
It's a gulag.
It does not help having such a scatterbrained, incoherent ownership group the way they do.
Jimmy Haslam, who should never own any team whatsoever. This was a guy who grew up as a Steeler fan, and now he's a Browns fan. What does that say right there?
Yeah. The bright side to being in Cleveland, though,
well,
the fan base is really, really good, and they're really, really passionate. They love their Browns. They love their Cavaliers to no end, especially considering that they are the defending NBA champions. But that's a story for another day.
I just want to clear that remark. I don't have anything against Steeler fans. I'm just saying, a guy who has no business owning a division rival like Jimmy Haslam, and the situations that he was indicted in federally before he even owned that team, and the fact that he brings a baseball guy to be the president of this team. I'm talking about, like, one mistake after another. Sorry. Anyway.
That's like bringing Joe Torre in to manage Manchester United Football Club. It just defies logic.
It makes no sense. I know they want to try this money ball aspect, but honestly, this is not the sport to try money ball with. Sorry. Do that with baseball. Leave that out of every other sport. Now, getting back to this particular game, the Steelers. You know, the reason why this game went sideways for them, one, Le'Veon Bell missing in action after that groin injury. You saw what he did the first two games, 167 yards against Miami, 170 last week against Kansas City. This time?
We mentioned turning points before, how the turning point in the Atlanta game was that fumble that led to a long touchdown drive. The turning point in the AFC title game was when Le'Veon Bell was forced to leave because of his groin injury. From there on out, the running game was completely non-existent, and they had to be one-dimensional for the rest of the game. You cannot do that against a team like the Patriots.
Several drop passes. Antonio Brown was also somewhat missing in action, because that's the problem. When you don't have Le'Veon Bell on the field to take most of the offensive plays, you're going to have to try to get to Antonio Brown, but he's busy getting double coverage, and D'Angelo Williams is your second back for a reason, and it showed yesterday. Despite the touchdown he got on that 84-yard drive, Boswell, for the guy who made 6 field goals against Kansas City, missed the first point attempt wide right. That could, you know, that was a little costly right there. And they ended up losing 36-17.
Yep. This just goes to show you, you cannot make mistakes like those, and you have to be at 100% in order to have any chance against this team.
How about LeGarrette Blount yesterday when he almost took the entire Steelers defense with him on that 18-yard run?
See, that's what I'm talking about when it comes to putting in the effort. We talked about putting in the effort in that Atlanta game. LeGarrette Blount basically did his Mark Bavaro impersonation when he dragged guys about 10 or 15 yards inside Steeler territory.
There's a difference. The running back, he has the prowess to do that and has the wherewithal to make sure the ball doesn't get out of his hands. Ripkowski, on the other hand, didn't have the wherewithal or the smarts to just get on the ground. I know he's a fullback and he wants to play like a running back, but sometimes there's some situations you can't screw around with, and that was not one of them. Because that was a big situation they needed to win. Because had they scored in that game, at that point, they could have been down 10-7, and the momentum could have shifted in Green Bay's direction, and they could be playing this in 13 days. Now the Super Bowl's coming up. Houston, Texas, February 5th. We're hoping that President H.W. Bush will be able to be healthy enough to attend the game.
This is only, if I'm not mistaken, this is only going to be the second time that they're going to have a Super Bowl inside NRG Stadium, but they've had Super Bowls in Houston before. Back in the 70s, the Super Bowl was held, I think it was either Super Bowl two, I think it was either Super Bowl four or Super Bowl five, when it was held at the old Rice Stadium
five.
Back in the day. Super Bowl five, which was
the 16-13 game, Dallas-Miami. That was when Chuck Halley won the MVP award, the only person to win the MVP on a losing team in the history. In fact, he said, "I don't even accept the MVP award because he played, because his team played that badly." Probably one of the most humble people.
Yep. He was no fool. He knew exactly what happened. Of course, with this being the last 2 weeks of the football season, there's going to be another big game taking place, and that's if you can call it a big game. I know the guys on each side, they're going to want to wish that they were in the other big game, but the Pro Bowl is going to be taking place this coming weekend, and for the first time in a long time, they're going to have it in Orlando.
And they're returning back to the regular format, AFC, NFC. The last years, they did this fantasy football, like Team Rice versus Team Smith type of format, which honestly, it seemed like fun at first, but now it's stupid. And for the first time ever, they're introducing the skills competition, which they've never done in any of the Pro Bowl games. This coming Thursday,
they're just pulling out all the stops to try and raise the sagging ratings that this game has been suffering for the last 20 or 25 years. But you could probably bring in the circus for all I know. This isn't going to be doing anything to raise their ratings, I can tell you right now.
Well, we're talking about Cirque du Soleil here. But anyway, look at the AFC Pro Bowl. You got Derek Carr, who won't even be playing. DeMarco Murray, who had a resurgent year with the Titans. LeSean McCoy, who also had another good season with the Bills. Kyle Yuzik, you know, the usual fullback from Baltimore. Amari Cooper, whose season really grew 1,000 yards with the Raiders, A.J. Green, T.Y. Hilton, Delanie Walker, Joe Thomas, who is a consummate professional, even with that sad team that he plays for. The Donald Penn with the Raiders, Taylor Lewan, Marshall Yanda, Kelechi Osemele, who was a free agent pickup for the Raiders, Rodney Hudson, if he's healthy enough, Khalil Mack, Geno Atkins, Jarrell Casey, Von Miller, Lorenzo Alexander, Brian Arakpo, C.J. Mosley, Tlaib Hayward, Harris Jr., Nelson, Pat McAfee, Justin Tucker, Cameron Wake, and Dong Kung Su, Jay Ajayi, Jarvis Landry, Richie Incognito, Jadavian Clowney, Leonard Williams, Travis Kelce, Marcus Peters, Eric Berry, Tyreek Hill, Ben Roethlisberger, Le'Veon Bell, if the groin heals, Antonio Brown, David DeCastro, Marquise Pouncey, Alex Smith, Emmanuel Sanders, Andrew Whitworth, Carlos Dunlap, Kyle Williams, Tarian Stewart, Dustin Colquitt, and Morgan Cox.
Notice no Jets made the AFC. Leonard Williams. Sorry about that. The only, if I'm not mistaken, I think he's the only rookie on the roster.
No, he's the only rookie on the roster.
And he was probably the best defensive player that the Jets had all season, which is saying a lot considering that entire Jet line was a colossal disappointment.
Well, he's on the squad. Well, he was probably the best, you know, on that Jets line. Then the NFC side, you have David Johnson, Mike Tolbert, Mike Evans, Larry Fitzgerald. Congratulations. Great career that he's had. Greg Olsen, Jordan Reed, Trent Williams, Jason Peters, Brandon Scherff, Everson Griffin, Aaron Donald, Gerald McCoy, Fletcher Cox, Ryan Kerrigan, Thomas Davis, Luke Kuechly, if his concussion heals, Patrick Peterson, Xavier Rhodes, Harrison Smith, Johnny Hecker, Cordero Patterson, a heck of a returner if he's in open space, Odell Beckham Jr., Janoris Jenkins, Landon Collins, Dwayne Harris, Jordan Howard, Cliff Averill, Michael Bennett, Bobby Wagner, Richard Sherman, Dak Prescott, Ezekiel Elliott, Tyron Smith, Zach Martin, Travis Frederick, Linval Joseph, Aaron Rodgers, TJ Lang, if he recovers from that injury, Clinton Dix.
favorite name in the NFL.
Jimmy Graham, Trey Turner, KJ Wright, Sean Lee, and Jake McQuaid.
Good seeing that quartet of Giants make the Pro Bowl this year, especially two guys who were such huge free agent signings for them, making up a lot of ground for that defense this year. Now, let's see what the Giants can do for an encore next season.
On this Pro Bowl team, though, honestly, of all the guys, David Johnson, to me, is my favorite on the NFC side. Just what he did this year.
Mm-hmm.
He went 15 out of 16 games with over 100 total yards on both rushing and receiving. Never been done in the NFL. To me, very well worth it. On the AFC side, and this is, you know, I have to say again, Von Miller, probably the best. I like what he does on defense. It's just unbelievable how he has a great first step in motor like nobody else in the league.
Mm-hmm.
He knows how to anticipate the rush, you know, anticipate getting to the quarterback and rushing the quarterback and making those big sacks. He really was unbelievable. Congratulations to all these guys. Have a good game on Sunday in Orlando. Go to Disney World. Take your families there. They probably deserve it for having to be without daddy for a full year.
Yeah. Although I have to admit having the Pro Bowl in a place that's not Honolulu is a little disappointing to me. I mean, nothing against Orlando. I've been to Orlando before. Orlando is a beautiful city. But
great city.
Think about it. Honolulu, miles upon miles of beaches, superior weather all year round, girls in wearing leis and doing the hula dance. And the people in Hawaii are so kind and so courteous and so nice to all the of the foreigners that make their way into the island.
Mahalo.
I don't know. It's just me. Yeah, it is Mahalo.
Mahalo.
Mahalo. Yeah, that's
Shaka,
right.
Or Shaka, bro, and you know, surfs up all the time.
We mentioned that this Sunday is the NFL Pro Bowl. Well, that same day, there's going to be another All-Star game that's taking place, and that is the NHL All-Star game in Los Angeles.
Which is unbelievable. I know, you know, L.A., I don't think, has hosted many All-Star games. This year, of course, talking about the NHL season in itself, the New York, locally in our neighborhood, the Rangers won two of their three games, including yesterday in overtime against the Red Wings.
Yeah, a nationally televised game that went scoreless for three periods but had such supreme goaltending on both sides. And then JT Miller wound up getting this really, really beautiful pass from Matt Zuccarello on this two-on-one break, and it was Miller that wound up getting the game-winning goal in overtime. And so far, the Rangers have played well. But I do worry a little bit about Henrik Lundqvist. He's really showing some signs of age lately. He's going to turn 35 years of age soon. And
they're playing in a tough division, though.
Yeah.
The toughest division in all of the NHL. The four best teams, really. You got Columbus, who actually has had a resurgent season. Washington, Pittsburgh, and New York. They really are amazing teams in this metropolitan division, unlike the other divisions in the NHL.
Yep. And whereas the Rangers have been trying to keep up with the other guys, the Islanders and the Devils right now, they're just trying to make a name for themselves. The Islanders have been a big disappointment this year, so much that because of their recent losing ways, they wound up firing Jack Capuano replaced him with the assistant GM, Doug Waite, who won his first couple of games. But then yesterday, the Isles blew a lead against Philly and wound up losing in overtime.
Yeah, they had a 2-0 lead, which is crazy. But the fact that they've gone 2-0-1 with him, that's really saying something right there. He's not going to probably be the permanent head coach. Next year, they'll go on a search. They're the second team to fire their head coach during the season. You know, the Florida Panthers fired their head coach early in the season, too. So, you know, it was about time. The way the Islanders were playing this year, they're in the bottom of the barrel in this league.
Yeah.
But they can't be as worse as the Colorado Avalanche, a team that hasn't won in regulation since December 11th.
Which is a month and a half right now. As for the Jersey Devils, there is a slight bit of promise for them. They came off this Western road trip, which was really, really big. I think they went, it was either 2-0-1 or 3-0-1.
They won four of their last five games.
Mm-hmm. And right now, the Rangers are playing against the Kings at the Garden. And hopefully the Rangers will be able to get themselves a big win, follow up what they did last night. That's the thing about back-to-back games. Back-to-back games, having to travel from one city to another is a really tough thing, but it's all about preparation, and it's all about how you pace yourself in a game.
As for the other divisions, like the Lightning are terrible this year. The Red Wings look like they probably will miss their first postseason in over a quarter of a century. The Sabres are just, well, granted they've won seven of their last 13 games. The Panthers are, you know, all right. The Boston Bruins, though, have fired 30-plus shots in 10 straight games. That's unreal right there. The Maple Leafs, you know, have won three of their last four. And then the Montreal Canadiens, right now, Carey Price has lost 8 of his last 11 starts.
That's, again, I say, how's that P.K. Subban trade working out?
In the Central Division, as I mentioned, the Avalanche haven't won a regulation game since the 11th of December. The Dallas Stars, too, have in their seven January losses, they've been out. The score has been 4-2, where they've lost the average score of games that they lost. Andrej Pavelic with the Winnipeg Jets, since being recalled, recorded 2 wins and 30 plus saves in both outings. That's something right there. The St. Louis Blues right now, some issues with the goaltending. The Nashville Predators, just another story right there. How about the Chicago Blackhawks, you know, with Scott Darling and that team? They, you know, the backup, he's been 12-4-2 with a .928 save percentage. Just the backup. And for Corey Crawford in the month of January, 4-3-0, he's struggling. He's got a below .900 save percentage. For your star goaltender, you need to improve right there, especially for that Blackhawks team. And the Minnesota Wild, how about this? A plus-minus 46 goal differential. They've had a heck of a season so far. I really like what they're doing in Minnesota right now. It's kind of reminiscent when the North Stars were there.
Yep. And it's been one of the Minnesota natives on the Wild, Zach Parise, an ex-Devil, that's really been leading the way for them.
And in the Pacific Division, the Coyotes are who we think they are, a failed, miserable excuse of a franchise that has gone through multiple ownership situations. The fact that they're playing in Glendale in a substandard stadium, and the only good thing they have is Mike Smith, their goaltender, who had 45 saves. That is, but yet they've been 3-12-1 in their last 16. What does that tell you right there?
It tells them that it looks like they're going to be playing out the string the rest of the season.
The Vancouver Canucks, though, actually are somewhat getting better. They still got the Sedin twins. The Calgary Flames, they've had an 8-9-1 record since they had a big run early in the season.
One of the Sedin twins just recently scored their 1,000th point in a game.
Probably was Henrik.
Henrik Sedin, who's had an outstanding career.
And then you have the Los Angeles Kings, who are playing the Rangers right now as we speak. Beat them. I hope you win against them. The Anaheim Ducks, Corey Perry, led the leagues in goals in 2010-2011. He's only had 9 through 49 games on the season. He's really got to get it together for the Ducks. As the Edmonton Oilers, Connor McDavid, the points leader in the NHL. Look at what a prospect they got in him.
Edmonton got a real find when they wound up getting that young man.
The second coming of, what would you say?
I would call him maybe the second coming of Mark Messier. There's always going to be one Wayne Gretzky. I would call him maybe the second coming of Mark Messier right now.
Definitely. And Joel Ward, the veteran with the San Jose Sharks, has done a great job. You know, 8 points in his last 9 games. And Peter DeBoer, good job behind the bench for that Sharks team.
That's Peter DeBoer, of course, is the ex-Devils coach who took the Devils to their last Stanley Cup final, which was 2012.
And how about this coming Sunday? Not only is the NHL having their All-Star game, and not only is the NFL having their Pro Bowl, but WWE, the first road to WrestleMania gets underway, the Royal Rumble at the Alamo Dome.
In San Antonio, and there's going to be a real interesting field.
Or AT&T Center,
yeah,
sorry.
A real interesting field is what they're going to have. They've already filled 18 slots, some of which are guys who have a really good shot of winning the whole thing, others who are basically afterthoughts.
We got Goldberg, Brock Lesnar, the two biggest names that announced back in November they intended to throw their ring in the hat for this for the 30-man field. And they have such a rivalry going back to Survivor Series where Lesnar won in 84 seconds. No, actually, Goldberg won in 84 seconds over Lesnar.
Mm-hmm.
That was the way he speared him.
Yep.
It took Lesnar by surprise.
Mm-hmm.
It should be fun. Then you got the three members of your favorite tag team, the New Day.
No, they're definitely not my favorite tag team. They're probably the most overhyped and, quite frankly, clownish tag team that I've ever seen.
But Big E and Xavier Woods, they're all right. But really, Kofi Kingston's the most interesting. You ever watch what he's done in the Rumble? Every time he's been eliminated, he has some crazy, convoluted way of getting back in the Rumble.
Yep.
He's done it on a chair. He's mm-hmm. done it. He's jumped from one post to another. He's done it on his hands.
Mm-hmm.
And he finds the weirdest ways to get back in the Rumble. He'll do it again this year. That's mm-hmm. what's entertaining about Kofi. He never wins.
Yeah.
Jericho, of course, a guy who actually just won the U.S. Championship. He's now accomplished everything in WWE that mm-hmm. he wanted to. Braun Strowman, think of a government experiment gone wrong.
I think that's probably the best way to describe him, a government experiment gone wrong. But he's a hell of a competitor, though.
Oh, without a doubt. His arm is the size of our heads and Robert's head combined.
That's, I think his hand might be the size of all three of our heads combined.
It's scary. It's scary when he throws somebody from one ring post to another. Wow. And then you got Seth Rollins and The Undertaker. That's especially the Undertaker. He's really a great veteran. Dean Ambrose, The Miz, Dolph Ziggler, Cesaro, Sheamus, Bray Wyatt, Randy Orton, and Luke Harper.
And if I'm not mistaken, that's 18 out of the 30 that have been filled, which means they have another 12 to go to try and fill it up before Sunday.
Yes, there's been talk of possible. Well, we got a caller. You're in the Bleachers.
And I think I might know who that could be. Hello, you're in the Bleachers.
Hi, Eric. How you guys doing?
Hello there. Happy New Year.
Well, Happy New Year to you, too.
Thank you. Did you have a nice Christmas?
I did. How was yours?
It was really, really cool. New Year's was really awesome, too. Did you have a nice New Year's Eve?
I did. Thank you.
Awesome. How's your uncle doing?
He's good. He says hi.
Thank you so much. Please tell him that we send our warmest regards.
I will, of course.
Of course, you want to talk about the Royal Rumble this coming weekend and about anything and everything else that's going on in wrestling, correct?
Yes.
Go right ahead.
Well, I'm gonna be bold with my prediction of who I think will win the Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a little surprised you guys haven't brought his name up in a while. I mean, since he made his way up from NXT to the main roster, and that is Finn Balor.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's
now,
if he even comes
Finn
back.
Finn Balor has been gone from injury. I mean, since he won the U.S. the Universal title and had to relinquish it the next day.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I can't help but think that, you know, the Royal Rumble can be full of surprises, but I can't help but think that if anyone can really shock the world, it's Finn Balor. I know I'm being bold about my prediction. If I'm wrong, I'm wrong, but that's what I got to say about that.
I'll be honest, you know, it depends on his recovery because he did suffer a really bad shoulder injury at SummerSlam, and he needs probably some more time to recover from mm-hmm. that. If anybody's going to make a surprise entrance, it should be Samoa Joe. I think it's about time he gets put on the main roster.
Absolutely.
He's had a lot of time on NXT. Exactly what's been going on with him?
They wanted to develop his character. You know, at first he was the good guy. You know, he brought him out on as a baby face, but he does not have the prowess for it. He was always a heel at TNA, and that's what he should be in WWE. And he really, they need like another strong heel. Maybe for SmackDown. Maybe that's where they're going to put him. Not on Raw, because you already got Braun Strowman. You don't need another guy trying to throw his weight around.
You know who Braun Strowman reminds me of? And maybe you could see the comparison. Remember the name Bruiser Brody?
I don't know if you could compare him to Bruiser Brody. I mean, I don't see that comparison, honestly.
Well, as far as body type is concerned, they definitely have a little bit of similarity. Of course, Bruiser was just such a legendary competitor that I couldn't see anyone really measure up to him as far as brawling and in-ring skills are concerned. But as far as body type, those two definitely got it going on.
But I wanted to ask you guys two other things. First, what did you think of Kurt Angle being announced as the first inductee into the WWE Hall of Fame?
I quite frankly was shocked. Because didn't he leave WWE on some rather unflattering terms? Not only that, but he was pretty much identified only with TNA for the last, I would say,
10 years at least.
Yeah, for the last 10 years.
Now, I think what happened was Kurt left on some good terms, you know, that from what I heard, and he decided to move on elsewhere to TNA, you know, and then during those 10 years or like the less than 10 years that he did what he had to do, you know, and they made business, he made money, I guess. And now that he's not wrestling full time anymore, I mean, I think WWE felt it was about time, and him and Kurt Angle, you know, it's about time that he took his place into the WWE Hall of Fame, even though Kurt Angle didn't spend like as long. I mean, he made his debut, what, 99, 2000?
Yeah, right around 1999.
99, and he left in 06, so. Mm-hmm.
That's a pretty short shelf life for a Hall of Famer.
He did make a lot of accomplishments. I mean, this guy, his athleticism, everything, you know. I mean, it's funny how he almost ended up in ECW.
Oh, wow.
And did you hear the story how that happened and why he didn't end up in ECW?
That's the first I heard about it. I would really like to hear this.
Now, there was an incident where there was a storyline between Raven and Sandman where Raven had a couple of wrestlers tie him up like in a crucifix style type of cross or something, and it was in storyline-wise. And Kurt Angle was there that night. He had made an appearance before that. Kurt Angle, after that incident, went to Paul Heyman and said, "Do not have me appear on that show. I want to be removed from that show. Don't ever sign me this. I want no part of this." He was so offended. He, being himself Catholic, he was so offended that he refused to sign with ECW and did not set foot there.
Yeah, that is really, really interesting. Now, how is Kurt's health right now? Because we know he's had the many neck injuries in the past. Could it be that his health is kind of cutting down on his competition time?
Well, he's been good. He hasn't wrestled in a while, but, you know, he's been sober, obviously. I mean, he's been clean, which is good.
He's had drug problems, hasn't he?
He did have in the past, yes.
He actually was in a movie recently, Warrior, back a few years ago, where he played an MMA fighter, mm-hmm. Kubo, a Russian MMA fighter. It was a really good role for him. Very little speaking lines, but the fighting prowess that he showed in the film, well, that's what he comes from. He does come from, he's a good ground and pound guy. He was a Greco-Roman wrestler representing the U.S. at the 96 games mm-hmm. in Atlanta. So this is a guy who has such a great background from that. From that aspect,
he also didn't have such a bright light cast upon him. I think he kind of brought his problems upon himself, not just with the drugs, but he also got arrested for stalking an ex-girlfriend when he was in TNA. I think it was Gail Kim, as it turns out.
No, it wasn't Gail Kim. It was another female wrestler, Raka Khan. Her name was, or something like that.
Okay.
But you know,
but I want to add one more thing. I mean, what are your thoughts on the passing of, speaking of a Hall of Famer, what are your thoughts on the passing of Jimmy Snuka? I mean, despite everything that, I mean, being with the court dismissing the murder charges against him right before he passed, I mean, what do you guys think of the whole thing?
I have mixed emotions personally because, for one, Jimmy Snuka was one of my very first interviews, and he could not have been any more kind to me than he was that day 10 years ago. But then when I found out that he was involved in a murder case with an ex-girlfriend while he was still married, that's when I completely changed my view of him.
Well,
and to think, I thought that some of these babyface wrestlers could continue to keep up their squeaky clean image outside of the ring. Boy, was I wrong.
Well, you're not the only one that was caught surprised. A lot of people were caught surprised by this, but at the end of the day, he turns out
that he wound up being declared incompetent to stand trial, so the charges were dropped.
He was acquitted. I know, and we'll never know to this day the real truth of that story, but beyond that, you know, and I know it sounds like I'm trying to put this under the rug, but you know what? I want to focus more on, like, his legacy, what he did. He was that high-flying wrestler who really was exciting to watch. If it wasn't for him, there wouldn't be no Mick Foley, because he's the reason why that movie did at Madison Square Garden on the top of the steel cage is what inspired Mick Foley to become a WWE star.
Shane McMahon did the exact same thing in a couple of pay-per-views. Superfly Snuka perfected the art of the
Of the
splash from the top of the steel cage. This is 15 feet in the air that he fell onto Magnificent Morocco at the Garden all those years ago.
Just announced the other matches at the Rumble: Universal Title, Kevin Owens defending against Roman Reigns, the Championship, Styles versus Cena, the Women's Championship, Charlotte Flair versus Bayley, and for the Cruiserweight Title, Rich Swann, one of my favorite new stars, against Neville.
Yep. Lynn, do you have any other words for us?
No, that's it, guys. I'm going to let you guys end the show.
Thank you so much, Lynn. It was so great to hear from you.
Good hearing from you, Lynn.
Be well.
Thanks. You too, guys.
All righty. Well, with a couple of minutes left, let's quickly go over what's been going on in baseball. Good news and bad news. First, unfortunately, we have to address the bad news, and that's the fact that two stars, one retired and one who is not even at the peak of his career, both were killed in car accidents on the same day in the Dominican Republic. Yordano Ventura from the Royals and the retired Andy Marte, who wound up passing away. Ventura's passing took everyone by surprise because he only had 3 good years in with the Royals, and he did not even reach his potential yet.
I think, yeah, there was. It just reminds me of a lot of these base players that have left before their time, and it's just unfortunate to see somebody, especially.
And after Oscar Taveras and Jose Fernandez wound up passing away in accidents as well, what more do baseball fans need to go through?
I hope we don't have to go through any more. It's really sad to see so much potential just pass away like that.
Yep. On the bright side, the Hall of Fame announced its 2017 class, and finally getting in is Tim Raines, along with Jeff Bagwell and Yvonne Rodriguez.
Pudge.
Yeah. Pudge getting in was no surprise. Tim Raines got in on his last year of eligibility, so congratulations to Tim Raines, a guy who spent 12 of his 22 years playing for the Expos and was a terrific player. Jeff Bagwell,
Houston Astro.
Supreme power hitter. Tim Raines, great base stealer. Yvonne Rodriguez, one of the greatest catchers that this game has ever had. And in the NBA, the Knicks and the Nets are still terrible. But there was a great game that took place over the weekend. Spurs and Cavaliers, and the Spurs came away with a big, big victory. And so, quickly, 20 seconds left. What do you want to add?
And for you movie fans, tomorrow, 8:05 a.m., the Academy will be announcing the nominations for the 89th Annual Oscars.
So that's going to do it for us, folks. For Rob on the other side of the glass and Eric, I'm Jamie. Good night, everyone.
Peace, Staten Island.